أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الرحمن الرحيم مالك يوم الدين صدق الله العظيم Brothers, inshallah, just before we start the explanation of Surah Al-Fatiha, there are many articles that we need to discuss just before we start the actual tafsir of Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. The first thing a person will do before he will say Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen is isti'adha, i.e. he will read A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitanir Rajeem. Likewise, he will read Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. So very briefly, I just want to discuss isti'adha, basmala, and then inshallah we'll start the virtues of Surah Al-Fatiha, and thereafter the names of Surah Al-Fatiha, and maybe inshallah, obviously we'll start Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen next week inshallah. The first thing a person will have to do is when you start a recitation of the Holy Quran, it is compulsory a person reads A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitanir Rajeem. Why? Because of the verse mentioned in Surah Al-A'raf. If I remember rightly, I think it's verse number 200. Right towards the end of Surah Al-A'raf, Allah Ta'ala says, فَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ الْقُرْآنِ فَاسْتَعِذْ بِاللَّهِ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ الرَّجِيمِ. When you read the Quran, then take the protection of Allah against the shaitan, the accursed. So the first thing a person will have to do is read A'udhu Billah. Why? Imam Ja'far As-Sadiq Rahmatullah alayhi says, the reason why we should read A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim, because before we started the recitation of the Holy Quran, the tongue is filthy. We have backbited, we have slandered, we have sweared someone, we have lied. Hence the tongue is filthy. Therefore, in order to purify the tongue and recite the Holy Quran, a person should say, A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim. A lot of people make a mistake when, example, just before they start a lecture, they'll say, A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim, Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim, and thereafter they say whatever they want to say. The A'udhu Billah is specific with the Holy Quran and nothing but the Quran. Isti'adha is only for the Quran. A'udhu Billah, you only read with the Quran, not with books of ahadith. With books of ahadith, you'll only say Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. So this is number one. Number two, we need to understand isti'adha is also a form of remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Abu Bakr al-Jassas rahmatullahi has mentioned there are two forms of dhikr. One is dhikrul lisan and one is dhikrul qalb. Dhikrul lisan means where a person remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his tongue. And dhikrul qalb, he explains, is a person goes into deeper contemplation and thought of the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is showering upon oneself. And thereafter a person thanks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is known as dhikrul qalb, remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the heart. Rasulullah used to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala even inside the toilet. But what form of zikr is that? This is dhikrul qalb, remembering Allah ta'ala in the heart. When you have Allah ta'ala in the heart, then a person cannot disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The ulama have mentioned there are 10 forms of dhikrul lisan. There are 10 different ways of remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with your tongue. Number one, which is known as one of the greatest forms of dhikr. This is a tasbih, to say subhanallah. Why? Because a person purifies Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from all defects and all faults, which is automatically praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well. To say subhanallah, Allah Ta'ala says, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu dhkuru Allah dhikran kathira wa sabbihuhu bukratan wa asila. O people who believe, remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in abundance and glorify Allah morning and evening. So there you got وَسَبِّحُوهُ بُكْرَةً وَأَصِيلًا. In the 18th para, Allah Ta'ala says وَإِن مِّن شَيْءٍ إِلَّا يُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِهِ وَلَكِنْ لَا تَفْقَهُونَ تَسْبِيحَهُمْ. So the first form of dhikr is when we say Subhanallah. This is also remembering Allah. Number two, tahmeed, where a person praises Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as we do in Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. We find in the hadith mentioned by Sayyidina Abu Malik al-Ash'ari radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, is mentioned by Khatib Baghdadi in Mishkat and Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi and other scholars of ahadith as well, where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, reading Subhanallah and Alhamdulillah Alhamdulillah will fill the entire mizan. And in one hadith, tamla'u ma bayna as-samawati wal-ard, it will fill whatever the gap is between the earth and the sky. The reward, if Allah Ta'ala were to give that reward and the reward was manifested in this world, it will fill whatever is in between. So the first one is tasbih. Number two is tahmid. Number three is takbir. To say Allahu Akbar, this is also a form of dhikr. A person is told how many times in salah to read Allahu Akbar. But as soon as a person leaves outside the masjid, he says, who's bigger than me? Takabbur starts as soon as we leave the door of the masjid. And how many times have we said in salah Allahu Akbar, which is Allah is the greatest. One of the first revelations in the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, halaki Rasulullah was a complete man of tawazu, humbleness, and he was a completely humble man. But what was one of the first revelations in the life of Rasulullah? Wa rabbaka fakabbir. Oh Muhammad, you mentioned the greatness of your Lord. Was there any possibility Rasulullah will not mention the greatness of his Lord? In Surah Al-Muddathir, which is one of the first surahs of the Holy Quran. The first verses of the Quran, Surah Iqra' Bismi Rabbika Alladhi Khalaq, the first five verses. Thereafter, Surah Al-Fatiha was revealed in its entirety. And this is the virtue of Surah Al-Fatiha as well. The first entire surah of the Holy Quran to be revealed was Surah Al-Fatiha. Iqra' bismi, only five verses were revealed. Thereafter you had the entire Surah Al-Fatiha. Then you had one ruku of Surah Al-Muzzammil. Then you had 30 verses of Surah Al-Muddathir that were revealed. In Surah Al-Muddathir you have وَرَبَّكَ فَكَبِّرْ, and you glorify your Lord, you hymn the praises of your Lord. So takbir. Number four, tahleel. To say La ilaha illallah is also a form of dhikr, where you are negating and you are saying that you are free from kufr and shirk. You are saying none worthy of worship but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to read Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, which is the third kalima. These are four different types of dhikr. And a person will be rewarded for every single one, and the reward is immense. We find in the ahadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the best dua that the anbiya have made on the day of Arafat is La ilaha illallah wahdahu la sharika lah, i.e. the fourth kalima. This is the best dua that a person can read on the day of Arafat, where you are showing your tawheed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The fifth form of dhikr that you can do with the tongue is hawqala. Hawqala means to say la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. La hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Rasulullah says in the ahadith mentioned on the authority of Sayyidina Abu Dhar al-Ghifari radiyallahu ta'ala, Rasulullah says, from amongst those things that Rasulullah was given from the arsh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rasulullah says number one is la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Number two, Surah Al-Fatiha. Number three, Ayatul Kursi. Number four, Qul huwallahu ahad. And number five, the last verses of Surah Al-Baqarah, i.e. the last two verses of Surah Al-Baqarah. Rasulullah says, I were given these treasures from the special treasures of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So hawqala, to say la ilaha, la hawla wa la quwwata illa billah. Number six, hasbala. Hasbala means to say hasbunallahu wa ni'mal wakeel. This is known as kalimatut tafweed, where a person is giving his entire self to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's giving himself to Allah ta'ala and he's saying Allah ta'ala is sufficient for me. He hands himself over to Allah ta'ala. On the occasion of Uhud, when the non-Muslims came to the Sahaba and said, you are in big trouble. Why? Because the kuffar of Makkah are coming and you will all be killed on the occasion of Uhud. What did the Sahaba say? قَالُوا حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلَ. Allah Ta'ala is sufficient for us and He is the best guardian. So you got حَسْبَلَ. That's number six. Then you have number seven. Number seven is استعانت, i.e. to seek the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is also a form of dhikr as well. A person turns to Allah ta'ala and asks for the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is also a form of dhikr. Then you have basmala. Basmala, i.e. bismillahir rahmanir rahim. This is also one form of dhikr as well. When a person reads bismillahir rahmanir rahim, he is remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then you have tabarak, to say barakallahu fik. You go to someone's house and they say, join us. As much as you want to, but you still say barakallahu fik. You ask them a few times and inshallah they say, you know what, I don't upset you, I'll sit down. Halaki, he wanted to sit down for the first time. Okay, but to say Barakallahu fiqh, this is also a form of dhikr. And then the last one is ta'awud. Ta'awud means to seek the protection of Allah against shaitan. Why? Because whenever a person tries to do something good, obviously you have barriers in between. You have the barrier of the nafs and you have the barrier of shaitan. So they will always be there to stop a person from doing good. Now, when you say A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim, there are different forms you can use. We find in the hadith mentioned by Hafiz ibn Kathir rahmatullahi in Tafsir ibn Kathir, the common one is a person should read A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim and then obviously Bismillah Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. The one mentioned by Imam al-Tirmidhi rahmatullahi in his Sunan, where Rasulullah says, you can also say A'udhu Billahi Sami'il Alim Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim. So instead of A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim, you can say A'udhu Billahi Sami'il Alim and then Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim. And then hadith of Sayyidina Humayd ibn Qaisr radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, where Rasulullah said you can also say A'udhu Billahi Al-Qadir Minash Shaitan Al-Ghadir. I seek the protection of Allah who is the most powerful from the shaitan who is ghadir, who is the one who will deceive. So you can say a'udhu billahi al-qadir min ash-shaytan al-ghadir. You can say a'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan al-rajim, or you can say a'udhu billahi as-sami' al-alim min ash-shaytan al-rajim. So this is isti'adah. So when a person starts the recitation of the Holy Quran, it is compulsory a person should start with a'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan al-rajim because of the order of the whole Holy Quran. Likewise, we need to understand a few more things as well. Obviously, these are important. This is why I'm mentioning them. Okay, and then inshallah we will carry on. When a person starts the recitation of the Holy Quran, you start the recitation of the Holy Quran, you read one para. Now when you read that one para and you come to an end, and you want to convey the reward of what you have read, is it you only yourself who will get the reward of the recitation, or can you convey that reward to someone else as well? According to Imam Azam, Imam Abu Hanifa rahmatullahi, and according to Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahimahumullah, they are of the opinion that if you have read something, after you finish, you should close the Quran and you make dua to Allah Ta'ala. Oh Allah, what I have read, convey the reward of what I have read to myself and to my parents and to my teachers and to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and to the Anbiya and to all the believing people of the Ummah. Inshallah, Allah Ta'ala will give the reward to everyone. But according to Imam Malik and Imam Shafi'i rahmatullahi, they are of the opinion that the tilawatul Quran, the tilawat that you have performed, only you will get the reward and no one else. Yes, if you do something else, example for Umrah, for Hajj, for any other good deed, and then you say, oh Allah, give the reward to what we have done to anyone else, according to Imam Shafi'i and Imam Malik, you can do that. But tilawat of the Holy Quran, they say it's the reward is specific to yourself. A person reads the Holy Quran and thereafter, alhamdulillah, you come to the end. When you complete the recitation of the Holy Quran, it was a sunnah of Sayyidina Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. He used to gather the entire family together and he used to make dua. This is not a custom that we have amongst ourselves. We just make our special dua and we don't bother about anyone else. Unfortunately, we are sometimes very, very selfish. Sayyidina Anas ki sunnah thi ke, he used to gather the entire family. And you know, Sayyidina Anas had a massive family. Sayyidina Anas radiallahu anhu, Rasulullah made dua for him. And you know how many children he had? Hafiz ibn Hajar Asqalani rahmatullahi and Mullah Ali Qari rahmatullahi have mentioned each in Fathul Bari and Mirqad, because Sayyidina Anas radiallahu ta'ala, from himself, in total he had 100 children. 98 boys and 2 girls. They were the two lucky ones. Again, 98 boys and 2 girls. And according to Sayyidina Hassan Basri rahmatullahi, he says Sayyidina Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, he buried with his own hands during his lifetime 125 members of his family, i.e. his children, his grandsons, Nawase, Potiya and whatever, you know, granddaughters and grandsons, in total 125. Sayyidina Anas used to gather them together. We have a family of 4 and we can't get them together. You know, this is how far we've moved with the technology of our time. It's so easy, yet it is so difficult to gather one family to make dua. At the completion of the Holy Quran, where Rasulullah said, at the completion of the Holy Quran, du'as are accepted. So anyway, you say isti'adah, you say a'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Thereafter you say bismillah ar-rahman ar-rahim. Which means in the name of Allah, the most beneficent and the most merciful. Now, bismillah ar-rahman ar-rahim, is this a part of the Quran or not? Bismillah, is it a part of the Quran or not? All these scholars are unanimous. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim in Surah An-Naml, where you have the mention of Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhi salatu wasalam writing a letter to Bilqis, the queen of Sheba. You know, there the scholars have deduced one masala, they have taken out one masala. Okay, if you are writing something to a non-Muslim, you are allowed to write Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. But just try and encourage him to preserve the sanctity of the words, the holy words, the noble words, where you have the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the quality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you are allowed to write it to a non-Muslim whereby you write Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. As long as you know, they will respect the wording of the Holy Quran or Bismillah. Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhi salam wrote to Bilqis when she was a non-Muslim. Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhi salam wrote to her, and at that time she was a non-Muslim, and he wrote, Innahu min Sulaiman. وَإِنَّهُ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ. From there we also take out another masala. Okay, when you write a letter to someone, you should write your name right at the beginning. Why? Because Sayyidina Sulaiman said, إِنَّهُ مِنْ سُلَيْمَانِ. And then he says, وَإِنَّهُ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ. أَلَّا تَعْلُوا عَلَيَّ وَأْتُونِي مُسْلِمِينَ. Bas. That was a letter. And what do we have? We have 5 pages and there's nothing inside. Sayyidina Sulaiman says, أَلَّا تَعْلُوا عَلَيَّ وَأْتُونِي مُسْلِمِينَ. Bas. That was all. Do not transgress against us and come here and you obey. Bas, finish. Bilqis, you know, she was very, very clever as well. She gathered the entire parliament together and said, you know what, we've received a letter from Sulaiman. What is your opinion? What do you say? So they say, you know what, if you want, we can fight against them if you want. They say, if you want, we'll fight against them. But if you want, then you need to know what kind of a person he is. So Bilqis sends to Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhi salam 500 bricks of gold as a gift. 500 male servants and 500 female servants to test Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhi salam. Is he only a king or is he a Nabi as well? Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhi salam was told through revelation that Bilqis is sending a gift for you. Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhi salam called the jinnat and he said, I want you to make a pathway from my palace that will extend 9 miles full of gold. Tum ek rasta bana do jo 9 meal lamba ho pura sone ka, made of gold. Not only that, you keep the animals on either side of the pathway and make them to excrete and to urinate on the gold. Jab Bilqis ke aadmi aaye, when they came, they threw away the bricks. Why? Because it is a disgrace to forward this to Sayyidina Sulaiman alayhi salam, who has so much wealth. But anyway, there he wrote, وَإِنَّهُ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ. The scholars are unanimous that بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ is a verse of the Quran. There, in Surah An-Naml. But is it a verse of the Quran, or sorry, is it a verse of every Surah of the Quran? You know, because at the beginning of every surah you have Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. So is Bismillah a verse of every surah of the Quran? Imam Abu Hanifa and many other scholars are of the opinion Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is not a verse of every single surah of the Quran. It is not a verse of every single surah. Yes, it is a verse of the Quran, but it is not a verse of every single surah of the Quran. Why? Because we know, how many verses do Surah Al-Fatiha have? 7 verses. But if you count Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, okay, according to some, this becomes 8. Although according to some, this becomes 7. We find in the hadith where Rasulullah says, there's a verse of the Holy Quran where it has 30 verses of the Quran. 30 verses. It will intercede for a person in his grave and likewise on the day of Qiyamah. And that is Surah At-Tabarak. And without Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, there are 30 verses in Surah At-Tabarak. So Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is not a verse of every single surah. But because Bismillah is a verse of the Quran, it deserves the same sanctity as other verses of the Quran. Therefore, the same ruling will apply. You cannot handle Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim that is on a piece of paper without wudu. The Bismillah itself, you can hold the paper, but not the Bismillah itself. You can't put your finger on Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. A lady who is in the state of menstruation, she cannot read Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim as a form of tilawah, as a recitation of the Quran. If she does Bismillah as a form of dhikr, it is fine. As a form of dhikr, as a form of remembering Allah, she can do that. A person who is in the state of janabah, where he is in need of a compulsory bath, he cannot read Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim as a form of tilawat. The same goes for a person is in the state of, let's say a lady is in haiz, menstruation, a man in a filthy form. If a person is to read Durud Sharif with the intention of dhikr and wird, you can. But not as an intention of remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when you read astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. It was a habit for you to read astaghfirullah on a daily basis. 100 times a person is in the state of janabah. The scholars have mentioned a person is allowed to read it as a form of wird, as a form of dhikr, but not as tilawah. Not with the intention of tilawah. Now, we have one name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Bismillah, one name. And two qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see why? Whenever a person does something, or let's say, if we put it this way, a human being goes through three phases in life. Number one, the life of this world. Number two, the life of the grave. And number three, the life of the hereafter. There's only three phases in the life of a human being. What do you do in your life of this world? You remember Allah. You remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. Because the word Allah means the only one who is worthy of worship. So the word Allah reminds us of this world. If we take during our entire life, if we take the name of Allah and we die with the ibadat of Allah, then a person will see the manifestation of the quality of Allah, which is Ar-Rahman. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show his rahmah in the form of Ar-Rahman in the grave. And then inshallah, the result of that we will see in the form of Ar-Rahim in the hereafter. This is why the scholars say, the word Ar-Rahman is connected to this world. And the word Ar-Rahim is connected to the hereafter. There's one principle in the Arabic language. The greater the number of the letters you have in a word, the greater your meaning. Rahman has 5 letters. And Rahim has 4. So Rahman has 5 and Rahim has 4. The word, this is why they say Rahman al-Dunya wa Rahim al-Akhirah. Why? Because the Rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encompasses believers and non-believers, everyone in this world. Whereas wa Rahim al-Akhirah, in the hereafter, the Rahmah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will only be with the believing people. So the greater the meaning, why? Because the people on whom Allah Ta'ala will have mercy in this world will be greater than the people on whom Allah Ta'ala will have mercy in the hereafter. So Rahman al-Dunya, and then you got Wa Rahim al-Akhirah. Now there's many, many other things, obviously I'm out of time. But Surah Al-Fatiha, Imam Bukhari rahmatullahi has mentioned the hadith, A'zamu suratin fil Qur'an. The greatest surah of the Holy Qur'an is Surah Al-Fatiha. The greatest surah of the Qur'an. We find in the hadith mentioned by Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, Imam Ahmad rahmatullahi has mentioned this hadith in Musnad Ahmad. Sayyidina Abu Huraira radiyallahu ta'ala anhu says, I'll just finish on this inshallah. Sayyidina Abu Huraira says, ki Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was in Masjid Nabawi, and Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu ta'ala anhu was performing salah. Rasulullah mentioned regarding Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b, Aqra'ukum Ubay ibn Ka'b. Ka'b, the biggest qari of this ummah is Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Okay, Rasulullah was told by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, okay, oh Muhammad, request Ubay ibn Ka'b to read Quran to you. You know, look at the virtue of that sahabi. Rasulullah comes to Ubay ibn Ka'b and says, Ubay, you read the Quran. Messenger of Allah, the Quran has been revealed upon you, and why, how can I read it to you? He says, no, Allah Ta'ala has ordered me that I must listen to you. Oh Allah, Allahu Sammani, oh Messenger of Allah, did Allah Ta'ala take my name? That you listen from Ubay ibn Ka'b? He said, yes. And obviously he is out of control, and the way he must have shed his tears, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b was the same imam in the time of Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu ta'ala, who was made the imam of Masjid Nabawi for Taraweeh prayers for the entire gathering of the Sahaba. So Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b radiyallahu ta'ala says, I was reading my salah in Masjid Nabawi, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called me. He called me over. I did not pay attention because I was reading my salah. Rasulullah called me again. So I hurried in my salah, I finished my salah, and then I went. And Rasulullah said, Oh Ubay, what allowed you not to come when I called you initially? What was it? Sayyidina Ubay ibn Ka'b said, Messenger of Allah, I was reading my salah, so I thought I could not answer you. He says, Oh Ubay, do you not read the verse of the Quran? Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu istajibu lillahi wal rasul idha da'akum. You must answer the call when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Rasulullah call you. So obviously he asked for forgiveness, and he said, Messenger of Allah, it will not happen again. Rasulullah says, oh Ubay, before we leave the door of the masjid, I will tell you a surah that has not been revealed in the Tawrat, in the Zabur, in the Injil, neither in the Holy Quran as well. The greatest surah. He says, we reached the door, and I thought Rasulullah had forgot. So Ubay ibn Ka'ab says, I reminded Rasulullah, Messenger of Allah, you gave me a promise. What is that verse? So Rasulullah replied, it is Fatihatul Kitab. It is Suratul Fatiha. The greatest surah that was revealed to anyone in the history of mankind. Okay, this is a surah that we are looking at. This is the entire conclusion of the Tawrat, Zabur, Injil, and the entire Quran as well. We find in the hadith mentioned by Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas radiyallahu ta'ala anhu, Rasulullah says, "Ta'dilu thuluthayil Quran." Surah Fatiha is equivalent to 2/3 of the entire Quran. So if you read the Quran, and if you read only Surah Al-Fatiha, you'll get the reward of 20 paras. 20 chapters of the Holy Quran. Like Surah Al-Ikhlas is known as 1/3 of the Quran. If you read Surah Al-Ikhlas 3 times, then inshallah you get the reward of the entire Quran. Surah Yasin, obviously again, that's of immense reward. Reading Surah Yasin once will be equivalent in reward to 10 times reading the Quran. And Surah Al-Fatiha is equivalent to 2/3 of the entire Quran. And obviously there are many other virtues as well. Inshallah, next week we'll start with the names of Surah Al-Fatiha, which is also very interesting as well. And then inshallah we'll start with the actual Surah Al-Fatiha. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the understanding of the Holy Quran. Brothers, I recommend the brothers read, okay, what Mufti Shafi Sahib Rahmatullahi has also wrote. I didn't have the time, this is why I've not gone through this. Regards, doing tafsir with your own opinion. You know, I'm not naming the masjid. I've been to one masjid the other day, not long ago. A few months back, I went to one masjid. Some brothers had sat around in a gathering. They had a tape in front. And the Qari was reading, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, or whatever other surah it was. And the recitation of one verse, the brother switches off the button and he translates from the translation of the Quran and says, this is the meaning of the Quran. Now, what is your opinion? What does this mean? You know, you have people in our area, we're not going far. It is a 5-minute walk from here. I went from here, and brothers, you believe me, it opened my eyes. It is in our doorstep where we have brothers who are doing tafsir with their own opinion. Tafsir bil rai. Rasulullah says, even though you do opinion, if you do tafsir of the Quran with your opinion, and you are right, even then Rasulullah says you are wrong. If you've done the right commentary, even then you are wrong. So you have to follow the commentary of the Holy Quran as mentioned by our pious predecessors, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Abbas, who was the greatest commentator of the Holy Quran. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us understanding what kind of a Quran, what kind of a surah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. And inshallah, slowly we'll try and get the understanding of Surah Al-Fatiha. So when the Imam reads Surah Al-Fatiha, we understand inshallah. Subhanallah, bihamdi, subhanakallahumma, bihamdi, fashiru allahi, wa bihamdi,